Okay, in this hand, I want you to focus on Paul Waska and how he proceeds with his draw. His thinking in terms of why he called before the flop, also how he plays his draw on the turn, and his decision to play on the flop, his decision on the turn to continue when the board pairs. It's all very interesting. Let's take a look. We got Rodney limping in with jacks here for two. We're going to see Al with a king jack. He's making it 10. Now remember, we're playing with deep stacks here.
So I have a pretty good hand here. This guy's pretty tight, and I have position on him. And queen 10 suited, jack 10 suited, all those types of hands are huge to crack big hands.
Okay, let's stop it right there. And what I agree exactly with what Paul says. And the key thought here is that it's really, really deep stack poker. So if he put Al on a big type hand, a hand like queen 10 suited can make, you know, it obviously can make a straight, it can make a flush. You know, flop a full house or whatnot. And it really, realistically, if you only had like $50 or $60 in front of you, you can't play a hand like this. But when you're sitting there in $1 and $2 game and the bet's 10, you've got 1,000, your opponent has 1,000, there's more than enough bets to justify making the call here.
The seats 9 raise wasn't really that big. I'm obviously calling because we're so deep, but now I have to decide whether he has an open pair or if he has overcards.
So you stop it right there. As you can see, Paul's already thinking, even before the action's back to him, he's already thinking about the raise that happened behind him, the fact that he's got a price. It's $20 more to him. He's pretty much priced in. It is a problem for him because, you know, obviously Josh has position on the hand being on the button, but it's not a big enough raise where he can throw the hand away, even, you know, though he believes it. Clearly, Josh has ace, king, aces, or kings, but Josh has queen, five. Anyway, let's roll it. We got Brad, who's suited, who could never fold that hand in a gazillion years.
Okay, so this is ideal. We have a multi-way pot. I got a suited connector. Brad is obviously looking to throw chips around, so this is an ideal situation.
Okay, and let's stop it right here for just a second. You heard what Paul had to say. It's an ideal situation. He's got several players in the pot. You are playing for a little bit more than you like to. He's got a couple of loosey-goosey players in there. You've got, you know, Rodney. You've got Brad, who've shown some gamble already. You know, you have the right kind of hand for this situation. It's not a hand where the flop's going to come queen, seven, deuce, and you're going to go broke. Realistically, Paul is thinking in terms of flopping a big hand and maybe stacking off against maybe Brad if, you know, Brad flops a pair or something. Let's take a look and see what happens. So Paul's going to make the call. Okay, this is going to be a fireworks flop here for Paul and Al here, who's got middle pair. So Al is deciding to lead out here with middle pair, betting 60.
So I hit my hand pretty hard here. I just have to be careful, make sure he doesn't have the ace of hearts, x of hearts. Betting at the pre-flop raiser is usually pretty strong. I think I'm just going to call because that widens my range of hands.
Okay, let's stop it right there for just a second. You see, now Paul's thinking for the call wasn't simply based on one thing. It was a couple things. It was, first of all, he's trying to widen his range of hands so it's not readable. He's also concerned about the pre-flop raiser that's sitting behind him. And also, the other key consideration is he still wants to play it a little bit careful just in case he's up against the dreaded ace random of hearts. If that's the case, then he's dead to just the jack. That's the only way he could win the pot. So definitely calling here. And I'd also add one thing is the call here gives him extra value. If you have Brad or Rodney who wants to make a loose call with a gut shot straight draw as well, that gives him an even better price on hitting his flush card. Let's go ahead and see what happens. So action's going to be back on Josh, who was just goofing around, dancing, but it's been bet and called. He simply couldn't make this call right here. And no, Josh is still Hollywooding. Okay, he's going to throw it away.
I'm really hoping Brad calls here.
Obviously, Brad has nothing, but Paul is hoping.
It'll probably be a call regardless of what he reads me for.
Everyone's hoping Brad calls.
He's probably got 9 high.
Good read there, Al. Brad, now we got 2 players, one with kings, middle pair, and of course Paul sitting there with the flush draw and gut shot straight draw. So now 3 kings for Al. He's just lucky to catch the perfect card.
Normally I'd fold on a paired board here, but he's representing the ace, and if I had my gut shot, he might hit. Well, I guess ace-jack would still be ace-jack, but I don't know. Usually I would fold here because the board's paired, but given the dynamic of the table and I'm in position on him, I think a jack or a heart is good. I don't know if he'll pay me off, but I think it's worth a shot.
Okay, and let's stop it right there. Notice one thing. He didn't just, you know, he has a flusher. He didn't simply just say, I call, or the board paired, you know, automatically I fold. He, first of all, put his opponent on a hand. Now, if he puts Al on the hand that he was representing, which is an ace, then all of his outs are good, unless he's already full, which is unlikely, unless he, you know, had precisely ace-king or pocket fives, realistically. So in this situation, he's actually, unfortunately, despite the fact that he broke the hand down right, Al made kind of a strange bet on the flop with just the king and was really lucky to hit that king on the turn. So that's something that's out of left field. There's really no way you could put him on that kind of a hand in that situation. So, but all told, you know, he figured his hearts were good. He's right about that. He just didn't know that Al had the king there. So as he said, he probably would fold in some situations, but in this case, he deduced the hand properly in the fact that, you know, he understands that he's still at least drawing live. And the bet size is small enough where he's still getting a decent price to hit his flush. Again, not certain if he's going to get paid off on the river, but it's worth a shot, as he said. Let's take a look and see the river.
Six of spades on the turn.
Can I make a bet when I get in the corner? Or should I give him a chance to bluff on it? And then I put him on a flush.
Paul on a king here.
I don't think there's any point to bluff. He's going to call it down.
He might.
Good check.
Wow. All right. And let's stop it right there. As you can see, Paul said rather eloquently, you know, he doesn't see any point in bluffing. He had a dead read on the fact that he was obviously beat, and the check on the river was one, and looking for, you know, the check bluff trap, if you will. He wasn't going to be able to move him, so he didn't go overboard. A lot of times players in that situation say, you know, the only way I can win is to bet, but Paul was too smart there and realized that a bet saved is like a bet earned.